feeling I got playing drums, it was sort of almost a religious feeling, you know? I was like mesmerized. And that was the only thing, was the beat, nothing else, just the beat. The biggest crowd Prong played to was the Dynamo Festival. We played to 30,000 people and we headlined it. It was like when we were really popular. And just playing to 30,000 people, it doesn't really have an effect. I mean, you look out there and you just see little ants, you know. When I played in bands, I didn't play for the audience. I played for the other guys in the band. I wanted to be the best I could. And if they were happy, then I was happy. I had an uncle that played jazz drums. He had some mental issues, but he was the best guy in the world. I loved him. Really, really smart. So I would go over, he lived with my grandparents, and I would go up and watch him play the jazz drums. And I would sit there and go, I definitely want to play drums. And then, I want to do that. So I saved my money from mowing lawns and shoveling snow. I bought the bass drum, and then I bought the toms, and then the cymbals. And then I was off and running. I was in this band, Swans. My friend Algis, we were playing at CBGB's and he came backstage. He's all drunk and like, man, you're great. You sound like Venom. I was like, who the hell are you? And why are you in our dressing room? And we eventually became really good friends. And he asked me, you want to join Swans? And I said, no, it's not really my cup of tea. And he said, well, we're going to go on tour for 3 months to Europe. I said, okay, sign me up. The sound was so loud. It was this power. The sound between the beats was more important than playing the beats. This kid came up and said, man, the sound was so amazing. It reminded me of the Romans pounding drums on a boat when they were rowing. After like 4 or 5 albums with Swans, I joined Prong. Saw this ad saying, Black Sabbath to Black Flag, looking for a drummer. And I called it up and I said, hey, yeah, I'm a drummer and I like Black Flag and I like Black Sabbath. And they said, okay, come on over. And that's when it started. And we made our first album. No one would sign us, so we just put out our albums. You know, it was Primitive Origins and Force Fed. And then there's a label that finally signed us, in effect. After Beg to Differ came out, we were kind of popular. We were on Headbangers Ball on MTV.
Headbangers Ball on the road. We're in Philadelphia. We're going to be checking out Ozzy later. But right now we're with the band that's opening up for Ozzy, Prong. So I imagine it would be tough to open up for Ozzy Osbourne, considering Ozzy fans are such like Ozzy fans.
Yeah, well, they are. We're going to give them a chance to respond with a flash of the set.
remember my grandma said, "Oh, Teddy, we saw you on MTV. You looked really good." I was like, "Oh, thanks, Grandma."
Yeah, I mean, Tommy and I have come a long way since like 87 as far as just, you know, gaining a lot of knowledge, getting a little older, you know, as far as being on the road and in the studio.
So we came to Norway for a promotion tour to do interviews for Rude Awakening. That was the last album that I played on. And this girl was doing promotion for us, taking us around, and her name was Tonya. And all the guys in the band were like, "Oh, wow, she's gorgeous."
I met Ted when I worked at Sony. There was something specific with that band. I had a feeling, actually, before they came to town that there was something with that band. I didn't know what that was at the time, but he was in town for like 3 days and we stayed in touch.
I was obsessed with her when we moved to California. And I wrote to her and said, I love you so much. I want you to come to see us play in London. And she did.
I don't know. At some point, we just decided that we should just try and be together. And that timeline went really quickly because once we decided, it was, you know, we decided one Christmas. In January, I left my job. I moved there 12th of February. He proposed to me the 14th of February. We got married on the 27th of February. And 1 year later, Hunter was born.
And then she got another offer to move back to Norway, and I said, "Let's go." After a while, my second child, Nadia, was born.
I love you, Nana.
The kids were affected by the touring, especially Hunter, I think, in the beginning, because that's when he did the longest tours when he was little. So it was a lot of Hunter and me. He was very close to his father, so he was very upset every time when he was gone, because for a little kid, 3 months is like 3 years. He all of a sudden fell one night when he was gonna go up and get Nadia out of the bed. I heard like a big sound and I ran upstairs and he had passed out. But when we went to the doctor, it went pretty quickly and he ended up in the hospital. And the news from the doctor wasn't positive.
They found two tumors in my central left lobe. And the doctor said to my wife, "I don't know how long, we don't know anything about this cancer. He could live for another couple weeks or it could be a year." I wasn't afraid of dying. I just wanted to stay alive so I could see my kids grow up. We are flying exactly 0 feet. Finally got your kite in the air, huh, dude? Perfect day for kites. Hey, this is the princess. How old are you, Nadia? 5? You look like a big, big gal now. I started playing drums just to have fun and being in bands just to have fun. I didn't be in it to be famous or be anything but a drummer for people in bands. I did everything I wanted to do, toured a lot, saw the world, made tons of friends. My main focus now is my family, who I love dearly. This is my favorite necklace I've ever worn in my life. It has a picture of my son, Hunter, and my daughter, Nadia. And I wear this every day because it's close to my heart.